Well, students, if you remember that in the last session, I did ask you that the next two classes would be basically the classes on the key recap, that whatever we have discussed so far, we'll try to look into again in admixed form, in a form of a mixture. So today we are going to discuss some 40 to 50 questions, and the same we'll do in the next session. This would help you to assess yourself, to realize that how far have you managed or you have reached into the understanding or in grasping the content we have discussed with respect to the questions that have been asked in the previous exams. So, with hope that you are all alert, concentrated, with everything back in your brain, in your mind, with respect to the biological science in the section of the general sciences. Let's go to the first question. One of the major characteristics of prokaryotic cell is the prokaryotic cell, that is the primitive cell, as we have discussed earlier. So now here are the four options: absence of cell membrane, absence of chromatin material, absence of mitochondria, incapability to synthesize proteins. Now, if we look at the one of the basic difference between the prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell is that the prokaryotic cells lack membrane-bound organelles. If you remember membrane, bound organelles, and we know mitochondria is a membrane bound organelle. That means here is a cell without a mitochondria. Naturally, then it is ought to be a prokaryotic cell. As far as chromatin material is there, it's there in both. Cell membrane is present in both. Synthesizing protein is a part of life. It's there in both. Hence, option C is the correct one. Next, an exception to the cell theory is an exception. If you remember, it was in 1838. 39, Chavan and Chittenden proposed cell theory, according to which all organisms are made up of cells. Cell is the structure and function unit of life. Each cell arises from the pre-existing cell. But then the question says an exception. That means something that cannot be considered as a cell, as a living cell at its own. And we are all aware that viruses are the one that lie at the borderline of living and non-living. Here's the line. This line is the line of virus, because once they are in contact of the living host, they act as living. Once they are outside, they are not in contact of the living host, they are non-living, like a chemical, right? Hence the option is A. Next, in modern system of classification, modern system of classification, you know, is the five kingdom system. Five kingdom system, which include Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. And here the question states, in modern system of classification proposed by R. Whittaker, the fungi is naturally, it is a kingdom. Because here is the third kingdom in the category, in the classification of the R. Whittaker, is none but is the fungi. So the correct option is kingdom. Next, the gastric acid. Gastric, when it comes to something related to stomach. That is, the acid produced in human stomach is sulfuric acid, nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, or phosphoric acid. Sulfuric acid, H2SO4, nitric acid, HNO3, hydrochloric acid, HCl, phosphoric acid, H3PO4. So, which of these four acid is present or is secreted in the stomach? The correct option is none but is the hydrochloric acid, HCl, because the pH of the food once in the stomach is about 2. There is a pH value of food content present in the stomach, and the liquefied food content in the stomach, you are aware, is what we call as chyme, C-H-Y-M-E. Liquefied food present in stomach is chyme, and its pH range is about 2. And the acidic condition is because of the presence of hydrochloric acid present in the gastric juice produced and secreted by the cells present in the lining of stomach or gastric wall. Next, the bright sunlight is a rich source of, you realize that in winters, in summer already sunlight is there, but in winters we prefer to bask. Bask means to sit. In sun. In sunlight, not in sun, but in sunlight. That is to enjoy the warmth of the sunlight. But while we are absorbing the warmth of the sunlight, what happens? The UV rays, ultraviolet rays, though they are harmful, but a fraction of these ultraviolet rays present in the sunlight, they convert one of the chemical present in the human skin cells into vitamin D. And therefore, it is also called as sunlight vitamin. Sunlight vitamin, or even some do call it as natural vitamin. Although all are natural because we get it from nature, whether plant or animal food, but it's more a non-nutritive form of the vitamin that we get from sunlight. Hence, the correct option is D. Next, the vitamin necessary for the normal blood coagulation. Blood coagulation means blood clotting. Clotting is that whenever we get a cut in the skin, what happens? The blood starts oozing out. Soon after some time, what happens? At the point of cut, a clot is formed. A plug is formed. And this plug, which is dark brown in color, I repeat, dark brown in color, prevents the flow, outflow of the blood from the blood vessel that might have got injured inside the in the skin because of the cut. Now, from here, from the time of the blood flowing, blood has started flowing to the point that a plug has been formed, the blood clot has been formed, the process which take place is what we call as blood clotting. And it's not a one-step process. It is not a one-step process. There are a number of steps involved successively. And one of those steps requires the presence of a vitamin. And that vitamin is none but is vitamin K. Therefore, if vitamin K is deficient in the body, what will happen? That step, which is a part of the blood coagulation, will not occur or will not happen. And not happening of that step would then interfere with the blood clotting. Therefore, vitamin K is considered as a vitamin necessary for the blood clotting. Any deficiency of vitamin K may lead to an excessive blood loss because of the non-coagulation, because of the failure of blood coagulation to take place in the body. Right? Next, hemoglobin, we all know is present in the RBC, is an iron pigment present in RBC, red blood cells. And we also know it is responsible for the transport of oxygen from the alveoli in the lungs to the body cells. Now, it is an iron pigment. And in chemistry, we have learned that iron is a transition element. It exists. It has got or it exists in different oxidation states. That is, it can exist. We can find the iron in the form of FeO, or we can form it in the form of Fe2O3. That means here the iron has got the valency of 2. Whereas here the iron has got the valency of 3. Now, iron is an important constituent of hemoglobin. The question is asking, in the making of or in the synthesis of hemoglobin, which of these two irons are used, or both of them are used, or none? That means no iron is used. So the options are iron 3, iron 2, both iron 2 and 3, neither iron 2 nor 3. That means it's not iron but some other element is used, some other metal ion is used. So, but D is not an option because the statement is already saying that hemoglobin is an iron pigment. That means it contains iron. Hence, we are left with only two and both 2 and 3. The correct option is 2. Iron 2, that is this form of iron, is the one which is used in the synthesis of hemoglobin. If iron becomes 3, and it can become, it can become Fe3 in the hemoglobin. But then it wouldn't be red in color. It would be dark brown, like a chocolate brown in color, just like the clot. As the clot is formed, the hemoglobin present in the RBC come in direct contact with the atmospheric air. Iron get oxidized, Fe2 get oxidized to Fe3. And once it happens, the color changes from red to dark brown. Therefore, even if someone had happened to drop a blood, once it comes out of the body, out of the blood vessels, you compare the blood, the color of the blood, you will find the color of the blood is dark brown instead of being red, as is in the blood vessels. Flowing the blood flowing in the blood vessels inside the body. The major difference is the form of the iron it is in, Fe2 or Fe3. Fe2 red, Fe3 dark brown, chocolate brown. So, next question then goes, the chamber having the thickest walls in human heart. Human heart, we are aware, has got four chambers, 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. That is right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. Now, which of these has got the thickest wall? Right atrium, right ventricle, or left atrium? If we look at atrium, whether right or left, are receiving chambers, whereas ventricles are the pumping chambers. Now, naturally, the walls of the pumping chambers are going to be thicker as compared to the one that are receiving. So, the vent atriums are out. That means option A and D can't be the answer. Now, what we are left with, right and left? In right ventricle pumps the blood only to the lungs. Whereas left ventricle is pumping the blood to body. Now, where the blood need to be exerted more pressure? Because his lung and his heart and his lung, the distance is very small. Whereas when we consider heart to kidney or heart to the limbs or foot, the distance is more. That means the pressure needs to be more. And who is doing that? That's the left ventricle. So the correct option is the left ventricle. That means, in simple words, left ventricle, that is the fourth chamber of the heart, has the thickest of the walls because it needs to exert enough pressure on the blood so that it could flow down up to the toe or against the gravity to the head, region. Because you know in physics, you might have studied the force of gravity acts that prevents anything from rising. If something is rising, that means the force applied has to be greater than the force of gravity. So that means there has to be enough pressure on the blood to make it to flow to the head from heart, from the chest line, this line. Next. the plant tissues which help the aquatic plants to float in water is. There is a particular type of tissue present in hydrophytes. Aquatic plants we also called as hydrophytes. Now, which tissue help these plants to float on water surface, in water reservoirs, whether it's pond, lake, river, whatever the case may be, or oceans? The options are hydrochyma, parenchyma, polenchyma, or transition chyma. If we look at it, if you go back to your understanding of physics, you might have heard of that there are submarines, right? There are pisces, fishes, or birds. What they have? Birds have got the air sacs. Fishes have got air bladders. Submarines also have got the air vacuum system. That means if they have to rise, they fill the chamber with air. That reduces their density and they rise up. And when they evacuate the air, they pull the air out, the density increases and they sink. And this natural system of having a permanent floating pattern in plants is because of parenchyma. These are the special type of parenchyma plant tissues, in which if this is the cell, normally this is the cell wall, normally a plant cell has got major portion of it covered with a vacuole which is filled with the water and minerals. But parenchyma in form of parenchyma do not have this water. What it has got is air. And because the presence of air, there is more buoyant force that act. And as this buoyant force act on each and every individual cell of the plant part, what happens? The plant in totality floats on the water surface, and hence the correct option is none but is parenchyma. Next, the dead plant tissue. Now, when we talk of dead plant tissues, we are talking of sclerenchyma, responsible for the transport of water. Which tissue is responsible for the transport of water? There are two tissues that we call as vascular tissues. And these are xylem and phloem. And if we look into it, xylem is responsible for transport of water and minerals, whereas phloem is responsible for the transport of food or solute. So the question states, the dead plant is responsible for transport of water in higher plants is. Naturally, the correct option goes to xylem. Xylem as a vascular tissue is dead, except that it is the living xylem parenchyma cells. The other components of the xylem are dead. And it is through this xylem that the transport of water takes place under the transpiration pull, that as the water is lost from the surface of leaf, water is being pulled up to the leaf, irrespective of the height at which the leaf is, whether it's 1 meter, 5 centimeters, is more than 100 meters, because the tallest of the tree we know so far is 114 meter. a eucalyptus tree that you might have heard or you might have seen in your surroundings. Next, the cells whose turgidity regulate the opening and closing of stomata. Stomata, if you recall, are the microscopic structures or pores or holes found on the surface of the leaf through which excessive of the water present in the plant leaves get lost or is evaporated in the form of vapors. And during the course, as the water is getting evaporated, the gaseous exchange also take place. Now, if we look at this stomata, a stomata in the leaf surface is like this. This is a cell. Like this. This is the opening. That is, it's like this. They are like this. There is one cell, this is another cell. When the opening widens, they become like this, stomata opens. When water is lost, they come closer and stomata closes. So that's how that it is happening, like this. If they are this, their stomata is open, that means there is a lot of water inside the cells. That means the cells have got turgid. And if water is lost, water will go out, cell will shrink and will come closer. And as these opposite cells come closer, the stomata closes. Now, which cells are these that are making the stomata to open and close? These cells are none but are the guard cells. Therefore, they have been called as the guard cells. With companion cells, you know, they are present in the phloem. Stenocytes, they are type of cells which are present in the modified structure of the skeletal system. Phloem cells are the cells present in platy elements, that is flatworms only, where they perform the function of excretion. So, the correct option goes to guard cells. Next, the urea and uric acid are produced on the degradation of excess of proteins is in. Means, if we eat excess of protein, what happens? Body has got, doesn't have much of the system to store the excess of protein. What will happen is that the newly taken protein would replace the previous protein, the old proteins. And as those proteins are being replaced, they cannot be excreted as proteins because they are very big molecules. Therefore, they are broken down to produce urea or uric acid or urea and uric acid. Now, where does this breaking down of proteins into urea and uric acid take place? That's the question. And the answer is none but is liver. It is the liver cells, hepatic cells, that we call as hepatic cells. That the conversion of excess of the proteins, proteins will first break down to amino acids, then these amino acids will break down. It's like this. Proteins to amino acids. Amino acids will produce ammonia and then ammonia would combine with carbon dioxide to produce urea, and all this conversion would take place in the hepatic cells, and these hepatic cells are the cells of the liver. So that is the liver is the part. Next, which of the following is not a fish? You say fish is the class that we call as spices. Chordata. They can be cartilage or bony. But in some of the cases of animals, because of their behavior, because of the body structure, or any other reason, their mode of living, their habitat, though they are not fish, they have been given the name of fish, like starfish. Starfish is actually not a fish. It doesn't possess any gills, etc., or fins. But it is found at the bottom of the oceans. And hence, it looks like a fish, but is not. It belongs to Echinodermata. So it is not a fish. Silverfish, it is called a fish, it's an insect form, belongs to Arthropoda. Insecta. So again, it is not a fish. Cuttlefish, it belongs to Mollusca. Again, not a fish, but yet called a fish because of its structure and shape. And the question says, which is not a fish? None of them is a fish. And hence, option D is the correct. And this type of the question has been asked over and over again in the previous year exams. Next. The percentage of carbon dioxide present in the exhaled air. If we compare the exhaled air with the inhaled air, or inhaled air with the exhaled air, what I realize is that if it is inhaled air and exhaled, I talk of oxygen, I talk of carbon dioxide. Inhaled air contains 21% of oxygen. Exhaled contain about 17%. Inhaled the air that I am breathing in, exhaled the air I am breathing out. Similarly, the air I am breathing in contains 0.04% of carbon dioxide, where the air I exhale contains about 4% of carbon dioxide. Oxide. Hence, the correct option is C. Next, mycorrhiza found associated with the roots of fire plants in symbiotic relationship. Symbiotic means eating together, sharing together on the same table, like there is a bowl lying. You want, you take it, I want, I take it. Right? There is no fighting. Clear? So, any relationship between the two organisms in which they live together and they share the food together is called the symbiotic relationship. Am I right? Lichens are those, is the example. In the nitrogen fixation, you have heard of root nodules where there are bacteria which get food from the plant, but help the plant fix nitrogen to absorb the nitrogen. There are pretty good number of examples of this, like suckerfish, that there is a big fish and a small fish follows it. Right? When the big fish hunt, some of the pieces of the flesh falls down, the small fish drags it. same like lion and wolf or jackals or leopard and jackals, etc. So such sort of relationships are called the symbiotic relationship. Now mycorrhiza are a type of organisms. They grow on the surface of the plant roots of higher plants or even the inner weight. They develop inside the roots also. Now, what are these organisms, or what type, what class of these organisms are? Are they small green plants? Naturally, green plants are not found in the soil. Anything green has to be above the surface of earth. So the first is not a correct option. Bacteria. Bacteria is not a plant. Cyanobacteria is again prokaryotic and cannot be considered as a plant. So the only option left is fungi. Mycorrhizae are a type of fungi that are seen or found grown on the surface of some of the higher plant roots to help the plant absorb more of the water and minerals from the soil. Right?